Did Ty Gibbs know about the JGR engineer scandal months ago? Welcome back to Break Hard. I'm Matt, debuting the new Break Hard long sleeve shirt today. I don't necessarily love the color of the logo against the dark gray of the shirt. The shirt's a little bit darker gray than I expected, so we'll go back to the drawing board on this one. But also, comments talk about my hair all the time and they say, oh, at least you didn't brush your hair out of your face today. Guess what? Not brushing my hair out of my face today. Also, I'm aware I do need a haircut, but you have to time it right because the holidays are coming up and I would like the hair to look good for the holidays, all the photos that come at Thanksgiving, Christmas time, like that. So for everybody says, hey, get your haircut again. I'm aware. Maybe I'll just grow it out. Make everybody in the comments angry. But getting into today's actual news. Obviously, one of the biggest stories in NASCAR right now is this JGR, Joe Gibbs Racing engineer scandal that we have going on. If you missed it, didn't watch yesterday's video, didn't see the story that the Associated Press posted and shared, essentially what's happening here is a Joe Gibbs Racing engineer is in a contract year. His contract's up at the end of their contract is up at the end of the season, and they've been having conversations with other teams about future possibilities. Obviously, makes a lot of sense, but apparently, they've also been sharing some inside information, some proprietary information to Joe Gibbs Racing. And according to the Associated Press, one team that does not have cars in the playoffs did purchase setup sheets from this engineer. The engineer gave them setup sheets. This team gave them cash. You know how transactions work. Well, it got me thinking. I'm sitting at my desk on Tuesday morning. I'm like, man, Ty Gibbs said something interesting a couple months ago after the race at Richmond. Went back, found the Bob Pockers video, found my tweet to it.
But definitely question where they got all that speed from as well, right? I mean, they haven't been running good at all, and all of a sudden they are super fast. So definitely curious on that.
Ty Gibbs said, definitely question where the three team, got the speed from. And yeah, I think everybody at the time was questioning where they got the speed from too, because before the Olympic break, now remember back, before the summer break, RCR was dog food. They were really, really bad. I mean, Kyle Busch is a generational talent in a race car, and he couldn't even get that car in contention to win. Now, all of a sudden, you come out of a two-week break, and Austin Dillon is the fastest car on track. Fastest car by merit, by speed. Goes out there and wins the race. Granted, he did have the fastest car. He had to go all bulldozer mode and knock people out of the way, get rid of that. He still had the fastest car, although Joey Logano should have won that race more than likely. But where did they get all the speed from? Because after that, they still had speed. Kyle Busch was in contention, leading laps in other races. They've had race-winning speed more so after the break than they did before the break because they didn't really have any outside of super speedways at that point. And hey, at the time, everybody's like, man, maybe getting rid of Andy Petrie as the director of competition over there was the right move. Maybe putting Keith Rodden in there did right the ship. Maybe they figured something out and welcomed North Carolina, and they're not as bad as we once thought they were. Well, maybe, maybe not. So the internet is flush with rumors that RCR is the ones that went out there and bought these setup sheets. Now, I'm not willing to put my eggs in that basket yet. I'm willing to wait for the information to come out because there are other teams that could possibly have done it based on what the AP said in terms of cars not in the playoffs. So there's multiple teams that have multiple cars that weren't in the playoffs. So RCR is not the only one. They're just the one that everybody looks to because they've had this big turnaround in speed. And maybe they did do it completely on merit, which is great for them if it happened. But it definitely seems like some people, and maybe Ty Gibbs was tipping the cap in the situation. Maybe he had heard some things. And if not, then it just kind of looks good on him going back 2 months and him being like, yeah, I have no idea where they got the speed from. If they're the ones that even bought the setup sheets, because it could have been somebody else. People point to Legacy Motor Club because they're also in the Toyota camp. And listen, if Legacy bought those setup sheets, from this JGR engineer, they should get their money back because they have done absolutely nothing with them. And they are still some of the slowest cars on the racetrack. Other people are like, well, Rick Ware Racing could have done it. Maybe they did. Maybe somebody else did at that. Spire didn't put any cars into the playoffs. Maybe it was, them. There's a ton of, not a ton, but there's a few teams out there that it could have been. We'll have to wait for more information to come out. But it definitely seems like Ty Gibbs potentially maybe knew something before then. I mean, maybe was tipping everybody off. We just weren't aware of it at the time. A really cool story out of the Xfinity Series happened on Tuesday when we found out that Bubba Pollard will be making his second ever NASCAR Xfinity Series start in a couple of weeks at Martinsville, driving for the Sam Hunt Racing number 26 team. Not the singer, but the race team. I'm sure people still get confused by that. People still get confused when I refer to them as SHR, and they're like, Stewart Haas Racing doesn't have an Xfinity team. Yeah, I know. That's because Sam Hunt does in this scenario. But for Bubba Pollard, it's awesome. He obviously made his Xfinity Series debut back in the springtime at Richmond with Junior Motorsports and got a P6 out of it in his first ever start, which is a great accomplishment for him. Now he heads off to another iconic short track, this one being at Martinsville, a track that he's had success on before and a track that should suit his driving style very well. If you're not familiar with who Bubba Pollard is, well, I mean, pull up YouTube one time and just watch a highlight video for the guy, because he's won just about anything and everything in the late model category outside of the Snowball Derby, which he is still searching for. But he has won everything from the All-American 400 to the Slinger Nationals to the Rattler 250. He wins. He just wins everything that he gets in. He's been a competitor on the Cars Tour. He runs, you know, part-time schedule. He runs in every big money race that there basically is for late models at this point. And now him kind of getting into, you know, the NASCAR ranks and the NASCAR racing is a good thing for grassroots racing and for, well, race fans in general, because the guy is a big-time talent. Yeah, he's in his late 30s at this point. And maybe a switch over to, you know, racing NASCAR full-time really isn't in the cards for him. He's a father. He's a husband. He's got a business to run. It's not something that maybe is in the cards, but doing these one-off on short tracks is definitely an exciting thing, because more grassroots guys should get the opportunity to move up to one of NASCAR's National Touring Series. Obviously, this year we've seen Connor Hall get an opportunity. We've seen Brendan Queen, Butterbean get the opportunity. Carson Quapple, Josh Berry all came out of there. And I think we're going to start to see other guys get these opportunities, because these guys down on the Cars Tour and the late model tours are really, really talented. They maybe just don't have the budget behind them, but if they can find a car owner that's willing to take a risk on them and give them that opportunity, they have a really good shot of performing. I mean, heck, Josh Berry is now a Cup Series driver because Dale Jr. took a flyer on him. Same with Carson Quapple. He's now going to be an Xfinity Series full-time driver next year because Dale Jr. believed in him and got him to that point. Connor Hall, obviously, is moving to the JRM late model team, but I wouldn't be shocked to see him eventually end up in Xfinity car with JRM in the future as well. So these short track guys are getting opportunities, and that's really, really good. Really pumped to see what Bubba can do at Martinsville in a few weeks. On Wednesday, RFK Racing will make an announcement, and they put out a teaser image, and it looks like they're going to just release their 2025 paint schemes on Wednesday. I'm not sure if we're getting the Ryan Preece third car with Kroger sponsorship announcement, but thanks to Denny Delivers on Twitter, he took that image and went ahead and lightened it all of it up, and it looks like it's a 17 car that is in the reflection of the car that they have there, you know, as a silhouette. So it looks like it's going to be the 17's Fastenal paint scheme that is basically being teased here, or maybe what's his name, Elijah, I think, who runs the RFK Racing social media. Maybe he's just toying with everybody, and he put that RFK, that 17 car in there, knowing people would try to lighten the image up and see what it is. And now he's teasing everybody, and it's actually going to be a bigger announcement. Who knows at this point, but that would actually be really, really smart on their part. And that's the type of social media content that I would like to see teams continue to put out. RFK Racing does a phenomenal job on Twitter, well, all social media platforms at this point. Obviously, it's still expected that RFK Racing will have a third car next season full-time with Ryan Preece, more than likely, behind the wheel of it. RFK Racing believes that he has not shown his true potential yet in the Cup Series. I know that is a controversial take. I know there's some people out there that would disagree with that. There's a lot of diehard Ryan Preece fans. I am constantly amazed at how many fans he has, but the Northeast rides hard for Ryan Preece, and they still think that his best days are yet to come for him in the Cup Series, and maybe they are, right? Maybe this is the change that he needs, but I mean, the guy constantly gets outperformed by his teammates at Stewart Haas Racing, and I'm just not as big of a believer in him as a Cup driver as some other people are. I think he could be a really stout Xfinity driver, a guy that could contend for an Xfinity Series championship in the right situation. I'm just not sure that he's the guy that can do that in the Cup Series, but hey, he's going to get behind the wheel of some really good equipment next year by the sounds of it, and he's going to have a great sponsor behind him as well. So maybe there is something to be said for that. But for RFK Racing, expected an announcement on Wednesday. Could be paint schemes, could be something more. We have to wait and find out for that one. So let me know in the comments what you think about what Ty Gibbs said 2 months ago, Bubba Pollard making another Xfinity Series start this year, and about the RFK Racing announcement. Like and subscribe to the channel. Follow me on TikTok at Break Hard, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at Break Hard Blog.